Welcome to SDPB's Teacher Talk, where two teachers and a journalist explore what it means to choose teaching as a profession. I'm the journalist, Lori Walsh. Before we get to today's conversation, a little more about our Teacher Talk educators. Jackie Wilbur is a faculty member at the University of South Dakota and director of the Center for Student and Professional Services in the School of Education. She's been a teacher, a librarian, and an administrator. She's also an experienced registered yoga teacher. Gina Benz is in her 25th year of teaching. She teaches at Roosevelt High School and helped develop the Teacher Pathway Program. She's adjunct faculty at the University of Sioux Falls, Augustana University, and the University of South Dakota. Here's our conversation.
This is the third out of four in this series I created, and I just was thinking about my Teacher Pathway students who are now my colleagues working in the school system. There's two groups of them, and I just wanted to just put a little love out there. Hopefully that I have a little wisdom that'll help them so they don't make the same mistakes I made when I was a new teacher.
Yeah. It has to be so gratifying to have colleagues that you have watched question whether they wanted to be in this profession and then return to teach at your side.
Yes. I have former students who teach alongside me. I have one of my Teacher Pathway students who's doing her internship right now at Roosevelt, just not too far from my classroom. It's really great. And then on a smaller scale, my Teacher Pathway students went to the elementary schools today for the first time, where they get to actually see the things we've learned about put into practice. And one of them came up to me in the hallway later and said, "That was really great. I think I might consider being a teacher." And so apparently she didn't take the class because she was thinking of being a teacher. She probably just thought it sounded interesting, but hey, we'll see where this leads.
Jackie, was there a moment that you recall thinking, "Hey, I think I want to be a teacher"?
I don't know if I have an exact moment, but maybe a series of moments where it dawned on me that that might be a good profession for me to go into. And I also did have the encouragement of several teachers along the way who kind of gave me a wink and a nudge. I've been wanting to say each week as we've done this that I got to experience Dear New Teacher from Gina in real life starting in 2010 when we taught next door to each other. And I'm sure, Gina, I just think back on that time and I'm so grateful for you. I can't imagine how exhausting I must have been because I popped over all the time and was like, this happened, this happened, this happened. What do I do about this? How come this is going this way? I just was unrelenting and she was right next door and so nice to me. So thank you for writing this series for these students who don't have access to you in the way that I did. And thank you for that time.
You weren't exhausting at all. It was a back and forth. I needed you as well.
All right. This is the pop-in. This is your pop-in for today. And the topic at hand is you can't be their savior.
Yes. This has been a mantra, if you will, that I have to remind myself of constantly, because I think as most teachers, we naturally are helpers. We want to help people. We naturally have some compassion and also a desire to see justice. And so that can definitely devolve into a savior situation. And that's just simply not possible for any human being. It's not possible for people who are in politics. It's not possible for friends. It's people are fallible. No one can be your savior.
Yeah. Let's talk about the word savior. What do you mean by savior?
I guess I mean,
like, where is that line between I'm a helper, I'm a teacher, I'm a friend, I'm a mentor, and I am a savior? What does that word mean to you?
Ooh, that's a great question. And I really hope Jackie weighs in too. Mm-hmm. Because words. Words matter, and we all have sometimes slightly different definitions. So what does savior mean to me? It means that I would want to be someone's hero who completely changes their life. And when I say it that way, it sounds ridiculous, doesn't it? But, I mean, it also sounds really appealing to be a hero in somebody's life.
Yeah.
I've definitely learned, though, that's just impossible.
Yeah. Jackie, what's the definition of savior in this context for you?
Well, I think on one level, there's this desire in the field of education. People go into it recognizing that there are problems and that there are kids who need help, if not saving is one way they might think of it. That's how I'm looking at the term, is thinking that you can save people from heartache and all of the troubles that people experience. But I don't know. We've talked a lot about Abbott Elementary on this show. And
the TV Jeanine, show, yeah.
Yes,
let's do it.
And Jeanine Teague's the main character there, I think, particularly in the first season, which is her second year of teaching. But young teacher, she really has what I would say kind of this savior complex, where she's seeing every problem and saying, I personally am going to be able to do something about all of these problems that exist, from the electricity in the school building to students with low reading abilities. There's just this idea that she could, through her, I don't know, all of her efforts, make it all better. Yeah. And that concept, I think, is the savior concept.
Didn't she try to fix a toilet?
Yeah, a toilet, the electricity.
It exploded in her face.
Yes, she was covered in toilet water in one episode, yes.
The computers for the library, like everything that happens that she sees in a lower income school. Mm-hmm. She has an idea to fix it, and she's convinced that if everybody just had a good attitude and went out and did the work, that it would all be solved. Part of the humor is her finding and discovering again and again that it's a little more complicated than she thought it was.
So well intended.
Yeah. And that's part of what makes it what makes that show so popular and relatable and funny. But in reality, Gina, the things that you see are often more complicated than a broken toilet. And that's a metaphor for things that happen in the lives of your students that are traumatic and tragic and unfair and unjust. And dear new teacher, you're going to see how some people's lives become unraveled right in front of you.
Absolutely.
Were you prepared for that?
I logically, I knew that that would happen. I've had students who have lost a parent to death while they've been with me. I've had students who go through their own tragic, terrible illnesses. I've had I've had students get arrested and end up in jail. And so logically I knew that would happen, but when they wiggle into your heart and then all that stuff happens, you can't really prepare someone for it. But I think there again, there's the importance of mentors, where we can remind that you can't do the saving, just play your part, provide supports, provide resources, but you're not going to be the savior. It takes a cliche, it takes a village.
Yeah. Jackie, I remember volunteering in my daughter's kindergarten class, and there was a young boy who came in and his coat every day just absolutely smelled of cigarette smoke. And I mean, powerful, overwhelming cigarette smoke. And I just remember hanging up his coat for him or helping him in the little cubbies and wondering what his life was like at home, which was none of my business. But it was hard not to notice that he was coming to school clearly from a home that had a lot of secondhand smoke.
Let me quickly interject there.
Yeah.
I've had students come to school and their coat clearly smells of marijuana.
Oh.
And it's not because they are using marijuana.
Yeah.
It's from the home.
It's from the home.
But you were asking Jackie.
Yeah. Jackie, weigh in on this idea of the things that you are going to see, some of which are none of your business, some of which are reportable and that you need to take action on. But the emotions of those can weigh on a young teacher, on a teacher of any level of experience.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, I think all of those things are different for different people. There's certain things that we see as educators that pull on our heartstrings in different ways. Mm-hmm. And so for some teachers who maybe grew up in a home with cigarette smoke, they hang that coat up every day and are unbothered, right? And they maybe know more about what's going on with that student, and it doesn't pull at them in the same way. And then for other teachers, it's really heart-wrenching. And so there's a challenge there of knowing what your own pieces are of what's going to trip you up, of what's hard for you, mm-hmm. and where you might find yourself getting overly invested because of your own personal experiences. Mm. And so I think that is a very difficult thing to figure out, but the faster you can start to wrap your mind around how much of this is me, how much of this is me trying to be my own savior and remembering things from my own past or from my own experiences that I'm maybe projecting onto this situation or taking more personally than I would otherwise because of my own lived experience. And so that, I think, is a skill that the faster you can master as a young teacher, the easier it's going to be to help the students in front of you and know this is something I need to report, this is something I need to act on, or this is something that I just personally have a judgment or a feeling about because of my own lived experiences.
Ooh, that is a hot take. Wow. Gina and I are, we're doing that eye popping thing over here. We're like, okay. Because, there was a little judgment in there. I'll admit it. Mm-hmm. I was judging that boy's parents.
And also out of love, right? Like you are just saying, I'm worried about this student because I care about them. And what does this mean?
Right.
I also hear curiosity from mm-hmm. you in that situation of just what else is going on here? What else could I infer based on this information? And those are good skills that teachers have too. You sometimes don't get a lot of clues about the fact that someone is in need of help, and you have to be able to react to those. So I don't mean judgment in a bad way. You do need to make judgments about things as an educator and say, this might be a sign of something else and we need to look further into it. Yeah. But sometimes it is just a judgment that is purely that, and you have to be able to acknowledge that too.
Right, yeah. And I didn't say anything to the boy or anyone else. I just mm-hmm. noticed it and was curious about it. Mm-hmm. So there's that. Mm-hmm. Hair brushing is another thing. I remember one teacher saying that there was another little girl who came and her hair was never brushed. And I was like, please, as a parent, please do not judge me if my kid goes to school without her hair brushed. Sure. Because hair brushing is a whole thing that, on any given morning can be really tough. Okay, so let's set the whole idea behind of judgment, because there's a couple things that I want to dive into a little bit. One is this idea of what you're bringing from your own life. That's huge. And the other is this beautiful little nugget, which I always forget, and you always bring it up again and again, which is this is a skill that a new teacher needs to work on mastering, like classroom management. This is a skill. You can learn it. You can get really good at it. I love that. That's so empowering, Gina. If you're running next door to your teacher mentor and saying, I don't know what to do about this, mm-hmm. and your teacher's like, well, this is a skill, and here's how you learn how to navigate it. Boom. You feel empowered.
Absolutely, because I think we're talking about mindsets as well. Like, you can work at what your mindset is. You can have reminders. You can have a person who reminds you that there are choices in how you're going to view something. There's choices in having this mindset or that mindset. I think also what you bring to the classroom, it makes me think about how I grew up in this very idyllic situation, a rural farm, just a lovely family. I had a great childhood. And then I came to a large public school and I saw that people do life in a lot of different ways. Yeah. Families look a lot of different ways. And my way, my vision, what I saw isn't the way. It was just a way. And so that's what I brought with me.
I'm going to steal that line from Glennon Doyle and say, do your personal work.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So if you have, because we certainly do not only want teachers to come into the profession who have perfect, idyllic lives and whose parents love them and they did great at school.
Yeah, mm-hmm. There's too many of us.
Right. Mm-hmm. So, Jackie, if you come from a background where there was a little trauma in your education, maybe you were a struggling student, or you had really hard stuff at home, and you find yourself being sparked or triggered or extra emotional about mm-hmm. things that you see in these children's lives, where do you begin doing your own work? Where does your work begin and your work as a teacher? Like, you know what I'm asking here.
Mm-hmm. I do know what you're asking. First, I encourage all folks in the categories that you're talking about, right? Well, honestly, all walks of life make great teachers because all walks of life go to school. So that's... I try to communicate this in a lot of different ways, but I think that the school system is so much more robust when students have role models who look like them, who have shared experiences like them, because they can say, oh, here's an adult who's fully functioning and helpful and kind and grew up like me, mm-hmm. and here they are being okay, and that's going to be the case for me too. I just think that's such a powerful thing to do. And then that person, whomever you are out in the world who's thinking about being an educator, you got to the point that you're at. So you know what your coping skills were to be able to get there. You mm-hmm. know who you needed to lean on. You know what strategies worked best for you. And that's you being able to own those skills that you've cultivated and then share them with the youth of America is incredibly powerful. So I hesitate to be too prescriptive to say, like, definitely do therapy or do a walk every day or do, you know, X, Y, or Z, because I think that a lot of those things are so personalized. What sure. I would say is do the work, whatever it is that works for you. If you need to exercise in the morning, if you are a meditator, if you are someone who goes to talk therapy, whatever it is that works, double down on it, because you are going to need it during your time of teaching, especially early on. You just need the supports in place. I think that's been my number one advice as I've been teaching this school year, is to just start building those skills now of your support and self-care, because you will rely on it so much while you're teaching. And then that's also, I think, what we can show young people is this is how you take care of yourself as an adult. I'm doing these things right now. I need to do it. You will need to do them too. I'm modeling this behavior for you.
Yeah. And you didn't get here with no skills.
Right.
Did you hear what she said there, Gina?
I sure
like you, you're already in the classroom. You've already gotten your degree. You've already gone through the work that it takes to get there. You didn't do that by not having any personal skills.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
You already have.
It's hard to remember when there's a whole bunch of kids looking at you and you don't know what to do, right?
And to some extent, you've already managed, here's our word again, some emotional regulation.
Yeah.
Right? Words, not word, huh? In teacher pathway, my students who are, it's like that base level education course, we do a lot of work nowadays with, how are you going to emotionally regulate? How are you going to take care of yourself? How are you going to be able to be your best so that you can be the best teacher possible for those kids? And it's so important on the front end, as Jackie was saying. I'm going to put it out there. It's important all throughout the career. I'm thinking about the idea of burnout.
Sure.
And if we can take care of ourselves, find our boundaries, be the best we can be, that will prevent burnout and help. So we don't have a teacher shortage.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. We should do another conversation about if you're feeling burned out, how can you reset without quitting and walking away for a year?
Yeah.
You know, like if you don't want to walk away, but yet you really are burned out, if you don't have a sabbatical, or you can't make it to summer, what are some of those tips? Have you ever read that book, Burnout?
No,
I have not.
I'm going to send you a link, because I really was feeling during the pandemic in journalism, was really feeling burned out, and I didn't want to leave my job. So I read that book and listened to these two women's podcasts and took some very specific action that helped me recover from that without having to step away for an extended period of time.
I love that.
Because most people can't afford to step away, you know, for an extended period of time, or you just don't want to because you do like your job.
Yeah.
You just want to like it more. You know, maybe you're not liking it in that moment.
Well, and I think this goes with the theme again of this episode of the blog post, that when you're trying to do it all and be the savior of everything.
Yes.
Let's go back to that. You are going to burn out.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Being the savior of everything and all things, you are going to burn out. That is a prescription for burning out. Tell me a little bit. We've talked before, Gina, about, you know, you have an administrator, you have, you know, a partner, you have a trusted mentor at work, you have coaches, counselors, mental health providers. A lot of people listening who are in education maybe don't have that in their school district, but there might be some resources for kids with mental health issues. Talk about using some of those resources to alleviate the idea that you, as the teacher, have to do all of it.
Yeah, it's a tremendous privilege, but also, I hate to use the word burden, but there's a responsibility, we'll say that, that comes with being, especially an English teacher, where kids write things. and they write a lot. And thankfully, in a lot of subjects, students are writing more and more. And so this is extending to all subject areas.
Yeah.
But with that, there are times students just need to get something out. They just need to tell something. And as a teacher, we need to recognize that we're not going to save them from this. We are going to be we're the open door. And then we're going to show them down the right hallways, give them the support, the resources they need. And I am very quick to reach out to counselors or admin, whatever the support is in the building, so that my students have all the resources they need. And it's not all on me. It can't be all on me.
Yeah. Sometimes you walk someone to the next place and then you
sit
with them, show them your support, and then you walk away.
Actually, that's one of my most common things. I say, the student tells me what's going on. I ask a few questions, and then I say, you know what? I think a counselor will have some really good insights for you and be a great listener for you because they're trained to do this.
Yeah.
Walk with me. Let's go. And we go in, and we make an appointment with the counselor, or they sit and wait for a counselor, and I can often sit with them. Even if I have a class, usually somebody else can go sit with my class for just a little bit.
Oh, I love that.
It was my favorite part of being a librarian, among many other things. And honestly, this is something I did this year before the school year started, was gather up all the resources and put them at my disposal. So that way when someone said, this is the problem I'm having, I was helping by saying, here's the resource that's available to you.
Yeah. I love that, yeah.
I loved doing that as a librarian. I would be like, well, I know where the tax preparation help is, you know? And I could say, that happened actually at the library a fair amount, was people needed help with their taxes, and I am never pretending to be an accountant.
Yeah.
But I would know where the resources existed. And so a big chunk of my syllabi this year is just resources that the University of South Dakota provides, and we talked through all of them as one of my opening things. And then that was actually, I've been doing that a lot this year in my class. I do something, and then because I'm working with future educators, I say, here's the reason I did what I just did.
Yeah.
Why would it be important for you to go through all the resources that your school offers when you're a teacher one day? And so we had this conversation about how important it is for students to know all the resources and how you might not know what resources they do need because you're just meeting them. And so it's good for everyone to just be aware of what's out there and what's available.
Hot tip, the librarian is one of your resources if you have a school librarian.
Absolutely. Yes. They do know a lot of things.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, or your public librarian might have gathered all the resources together at the beginning of every school year. Ask them.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Use your resources. You can't save other people, but you can work at saving yourself. Or you can find the people and the resources who can help you. I'm trying to find the right words here, but who can help you do what you can to save yourself.
Yeah. Sometimes self-reliance and resilience means reaching out and finding. Now, look, that is an act of independence, is to reach out and find the people who can help you.
Yeah, that's an act of saving yourself, finding the help.
Oh, I just feel every time you come in, I just feel like the weight is off my shoulders. Let's close with this idea of, you know, from time to time, the stories will upset you, but there are also seeds that are blossoming that maybe you'll never know, but sometimes they come back and they teach down the hallway from you.
Yes, a student might have a tremendous need. There might be tremendous struggle. And it starts with dependence. They're going to depend on the teacher for some help and some guidance. But the teacher's job is to move them toward independence. And I think with that mindset, we can all be happier at our jobs and avoid that burnout.
I love that. Jackie, any final thoughts that you want to add?
Yeah, I love this seed metaphor. Gina wrote about it in the blog as well as just now. And I think a lot like actual gardening, you don't always get to determine what, in fact, you never get to determine what blooms, how it blooms, how long it blooms. But that doesn't mean you stop planting seeds. And I think that is the beauty of being an educator, is you are there planting seeds, tending the growing garden of these young students' minds, and you don't get to be attached to the results. However it works out is how it works out, but it's really a beautiful role to have, to be there while they're learning and growing and becoming who they're going to be in the world.
If you enjoy SDPB's Teacher Talk, tell your BFAW, that is your best friend at work, tell your administrator, tell the next generation of educators that this is a place to learn about the highs and, yes, the lows of the profession from people who love what they do. You can share, like, and rate the podcast. That helps us find our place in today's crowded audio ecosystem. Teacher Talk airs on SDPB's In the Moment Tuesdays. You can find all the companion blogs with links to the research on our website, sdpb.org/teachertalk, or just click through the podcast feed to get to our episode webpage. We are produced by SDPB's In the Moment team, Ara Youngeman, Ellen Kester. Our engineer is Colton Nicholson. For Gina Benz and Jackie Wilbur, I'm Lori Walsh. Thanks for listening.